Welcome back. Now it's time for our Session Extra segment. This week, we're looking at the Senate Law and Justice Committee. Joining me now are Republican Committee Chair Senator Mike Padden and Ranking Democratic Member Senator Jamie Peterson. Thank you both for being here today.
Thanks. Nice to be here.
So I know your committee gets a lot of interesting topics, a lot of hot topics, but one I want to start with relates to DUIs. Can you talk about the fourth DUI bill and why that's significant?
Well, the bill's been around for about 3 years. It came as a result of a task force back in 2013. We currently have the weakest felony DUI law in the country. It takes 5 DUIs within 10 years for it to be a felony. This would reduce it to 4. And it would help a lot in the sense that you're most likely to have a vehicular homicide or a vehicular assault if you've had previous DUIs. So we're working on it. The Senate has been very receptive. It's passed it out unanimously, actually 6 times in the last few years. We're hopeful this year we can get it through the House. Governor has said he'd sign it. The Attorney General supports the bill. City of Seattle, law enforcement, prosecutors. So it's got a lot of support, and hopefully it can go the distance this year.
What are your thoughts about the legislation?
You know, the House has had concerns for years about the fiscal note, and honestly, I think that that's kind of alarming that we're worried about the fiscal note. Part of the problem, you know, most states actually make a felony after you've had 3 DUIs. Right. And unfortunately, if you do that, it costs a lot of money because a lot of people go to prison for a while. Well, that says to me that there are a lot of people who haven't gotten the message yet that they shouldn't be drinking and driving. Because I think the statistics are that by the time you get caught, you've already been drinking and driving a lot more times and putting people's lives at risk. So I was happy to support the bill, and I'm really hopeful that this might be the year that we could get it done.
Another bill, another topic we heard a lot about before the session and since it started is the use of deadly force by law enforcement. I know there are different versions of bills which would change the statute that governs when officers are justified or when they can be charged in deadly force incidents. One bill would remove the term malice. Another bill would remove the term malice and good faith. Where do you stand on this legislation, and also where do you see it going?
Well, we both supported Senator Frock's bill out of the Law and Justice Committee. I think he worked very hard with the law enforcement folks and the advocates, and his bill would have eliminated the malice requirement, but would have maintained good faith and would have had more of an objective definition of good faith. In addition to that, it provided funding and training for law enforcement throughout the state. A lot of the rank and file law enforcement is represented by their unions are concerned with removing the malice, and as a result, when the bill went to Ways and Means, it didn't come out. So nothing's ever completely dead in the legislature, but its prospects don't look very good right now.
I'd say I agree with everything that Senator Padden said. I'd say that in the longer term, we probably are going to have to do some work, and we'll probably be able to get to an agreement about this issue. The actual malice language is unique among all 50 states, and is a real flashpoint for communities of color in particular who are worried about disproportionate enforcement in their communities. I think at the other end, we have to acknowledge that police feel like they've been under attack and are having a really hard time doing their jobs given the kinds of pressures that are put on them. So we need to figure out how we can get everybody's nerves calmed down a little bit, get folks to the table. And Senator Frocht has been doing really great work in that area. I'm hopeful that maybe not this session, but within the next year or so, we'll be able to get to a good agreement on that.
Yeah, I think one advantage is that the groups are now talking to each other, and I think there's a more of a level of respect and understanding of the other side's positions than there ever was before. And from law enforcement's perspective, they're very leery of anything that would make it easier to charge law enforcement. So I agree. I think that that hopefully it's something that will eventually happen, but certainly not this year.
Another bill that does not appear to be on any fast track out of the legislature would be the death penalty bill. which there was some discussion about eliminating the death penalty in Washington State. What's your stance on that? Where do you see that going at this point?
Well, the bill was not able to get out of the House. I had said that I would consider giving it a hearing if it passed the House, but it didn't even get out of the House Judiciary Committee. It's still a highly controversial issue. I personally don't consider myself a zealot for the death penalty, but I do believe there are certain very heinous crimes where that should be on the table. And I also think that there are ways that we could reform it to somewhat speed up without affecting anybody's rights. But some of these cases are taking 15 years. So any event, it's an issue. The people of the state are divided on it. I think there's still probably a majority that favor the death penalty. It was put for a vote in three states in the 2016 elections, and none of them took the side of towards abolishing the death penalty. That was California, Nebraska, and Oklahoma.
This is one where Senator Patton and I diverge. I think that we have really good evidence that the death penalty is administered in a way that's not fair. We know that's true in terms of the race of criminal defendants across the state. It's also the case that, as a practical matter, in our state, a lot of small counties just don't have the budget to pursue a death penalty case. And as a result, you probably could get charged with the death penalty only if you commit a crime in a few of the large, wealthier counties in the state. Finally, I guess I would say that given the plea deals that have happened with some of the most heinous crimes that we've had, and I just use Gary Ridgway as an example of that, it's really hard to imagine how it could be fair to impose the death penalty on someone else. Maybe one last thing, it's extremely expensive to administer. It actually costs more for the state to put people to death than it would just to lock them up for the rest of their lives. So for all of those reasons, I think that we should abolish the death penalty, and I'm very supportive of the legislation.
Only thing I would add on the Ridgway case, if the death penalty had not been on the table, probably would not have revealed all the sites and where the bodies of people that he'd killed were, which was very important to the victims' families. And so that's another reason that some people give that we shouldn't abolish the death penalty.
So moving on to the Department of Corrections, I know the early release scandal, the release of quite a few prisoners in state, and along with that, the discovery of a sentencing calculation error, which contributed to that. I know there is a bill that passed Senate Law and Justice Committee related to reforming that, sort of putting some new guidelines and oversight in place. Can you talk about that effort?
Yeah, and that came out of our committee unanimously. It's Senate Bill 5294, and I anticipate we'll be dealing with it either today or tomorrow on the Senate floor. It has a number of reforms and asks Jay Lark to do an investigation into the IT department, which was the source of some of the problems. Also strengthens the whistleblower program. We found out during the committee testimony that one whistleblower is a part of a settlement with the state. There was a requirement that she never work for the state again. I think that sends the wrong message to whistleblowers. Are they going to want to come forward if they know it might mean that they're never going to work for the state again? There's some other provisions in that. There's a major independent ombuds set up in the bill, which is also part of another bill. So we're hopeful that'll go off. We've also been working with the Department of Corrections, so we have an amendment that they've requested that says on the ombudsman bill that people would have to, you know, go through the state Department of Corrections system, but it'd be a cap of 90 days before going to the independent ombuds. So we're trying to work with the governor's folks and see if it's something that they will eventually sign if it passes the House, and of course has passed Senate first. So,
and I guess I'd just add that another feature of the bill that I like a lot is that it sets up a task force to look at the Sentencing Reform Act. The legislature over the years continues to layer on lots of complexity in terms of enhancements and special allegations that make sentencing really complicated. There's a separate bill, I think, that'll be coming over to us from the House that works on the judgment and sentence form. But one of the things that we know we need to do for the Department of Corrections is try to make it easier for them to figure out exactly how long they're supposed to be keeping individual offenders. And so if we can do that out of this session, I think that would be a significant service.
So one topic that I was watching even before the session or at the beginning of the session related to testing drivers for marijuana and sort of the complexities related to that. And there's a bill that relates to basically authorizing certified law enforcement personnel to collect blood samples, presumably at or after accident scenes to determine their level of intoxication. Can you talk about the status of that and kind of what that's all about?
Well, that bill has passed the Senate and is over in the House Public Safety Committee. And just this last weekend, the city of Lakewood announced a forensic phlebotomy program. All the phlebotomists, the law enforcement people, were trained, they've been certified, and it's very similar to the training that a phlebotomist who was not a law enforcement officer would have. And it's gonna help, because right now, of course, they're taken to hospitals. Not all the hospitals want them. There's sometimes delays in the emergency room or other places. And this has worked well in other states. And we know that while our alcohol-related DUIs are decreasing, drug and alcohol combination and marijuana DUIs are increasing. So this would help in keeping drivers off the roads that are a threat to everybody else who's driving.
And I recall hearing about saliva test strips for THC, perhaps, but there were some really complicated factors there. It sounded like that technology may not quite be feasible.
Yeah, that's a different thing. Where there, WSU is working, the research folks there, on a marijuana breathalyzer. And they've made some great progress, but that's not quite ready to go in the field yet. There's other groups around the country that are also trying to develop a breathalyzer to detect marijuana. Right now, there's a test that the law enforcement people give. It's called the gaze and stagmas test that the drug recognition experts give. And while it's been admitted into court, it's probably not going to be as reliable as a marijuana breathalyzer. So we're hoping that makes some progress, and maybe by next year it'll actually be in the field.
I understand that this year there was agreement on the committee related to gun legislation, or at least sort of a changing or a fix, depending on how you look at it, something related to the initiative that passed a couple of years ago. Can you talk about that effort?
Sure. So Initiative 594 passed in, I guess, 2013. Or is it 2014? 2014. And in the first 2 years after an initiative passes, it can't be amended except by a two-thirds majority in both houses. So during that time, the advocates for the background check measure really weren't willing to negotiate about the initiative and trying to fix some of the problems that had come up in terms of enforcement. A number of us who were on the side of the initiative and supported the initiative gave them advice that they really should come forward proactively and try to offer some fixes to some of those issues. And those include things like whether a nail gun or a flare gun would be covered by the initiative, transfers that happen for security guards between the security firm and the guard, when the guard might check out a gun from the employer. We had a number of those issues. And then probably most importantly, what happens when you're afraid that somebody might commit suicide? Are you able to get the gun away from that person without violating the background check initiative? So we were able to get everybody on the same page, from the Washington Alliance for Gun Responsibility at the one end to the National Rifle Association at the other end, and come up with a bill that addressed some of these issues that have cropped up over the past few years, and do it in a way that was unanimous and had good, strong bipartisan support. That bill's over in House Judiciary now.
So hopefully, yeah, hopefully they'll pass that. And I especially want to commend both the NRA and Alliance for Gun Responsibilities and some of the folks at the University of Washington for working on the suicide part of the bill. And so we're going to be able to have people that work at gun ranges and other things be able to better detect some of the signs for people that might be contemplating suicide, and hopefully can save some lives that way. So overall, I think it's a good piece of legislation. It shows in Olympia, maybe unlike some of the things people hear about back in D.C., that people can work together even on controversial issues.
What are some of the bills that you are either interested in that we haven't talked about, or maybe that you see coming down the pike at some point?
Well, there's a lot of bills. Our committee dealt with more bills than any other committee. We're concerned about property crimes. We've had a couple bills. One that would be a pilot program that would allow for some supervision. We're the only state in the nation that doesn't supervise property criminals. And then I have a bill, a habitual property offender bill, that says that if somebody commits a whole number of property crimes, that at some point, and this would be as many as nine, that the prosecutor could ask for an enhanced sentence, because we know that the repeat offenders, you know, create a disproportionate number of the crimes, and if you get them off the streets, the rate is going to go down. But it's an issue we're looking at from a number of different angles.
And I'll just mention a couple. So one that has passed out of the Senate already is a bill that came to us from the Bar Association and the Uniform Law Commission about trusts, which sounds sort of dry and boring, but actually there are a number of people with disabilities in particular who rely on trusts that their parents set up for them for support. Right now, those are very difficult to change once they've been set up. And so this bill would set up a process outside of court where it was possible for the trustee to change the terms of the trust with appropriate safeguards about making sure that it benefited the beneficiaries and that everybody was in agreement about the need for the changes. Yeah. The other one that I'll just mention that Senator Padden and I have been talking about for years is the need for us to reestablish a visitation statute for non-parents. Particularly for grandparents, but there are a number of other folks who, because of a 2000 U.S. Supreme Court decision striking down our statute, have not had access to kids. We continue to talk about that, and hopefully next year we'll be able to work on it.
I don't know if you have time for any more, but there's one other bill that's passed the Senate dealing with incentivized testimony, and we know from Project Innocence and the prosecutors, I think everybody knows that the cases most likely to have an innocent person found guilty are from witnesses that have been paid or gotten a break on some future sentence. So their testimony is incentivized. So we have something we've been working on for two or three years, and while the prosecutors are not 100% there, they're about 90% there, and that passed the Senate unanimously and would allow for some information to be given to the defense about an informant before the trial started.
So basically notifying them that their some of the evidence used against them has been incentivized. Is that's not the way?
Well, that's part of it, but also they could tell them other things about that testimony and other information about the background of the individual. And it would apply not only to people that are incarcerated, but some that are awaiting trial and getting maybe a break on what would be the recommended sentence for them.
So we've got we've got 30 seconds left at this point. In parting, what would you like to say about the committee and your role on it, how you feel about working?
Well, I enjoy the committee a lot, and I enjoy working with Senator Peterson. I think we work well together, and I think we've been able to accomplish a lot, and even though we certainly don't agree on a lot of things, there's a lot of things we've been able to do. So it's been a great committee to chair.
And I'd just say we had ditto from Senator Padden. We do have an incredibly wide variety of subject matter that we deal with, and it's been the focus tends to be in the media about a few high profile controversial things. but we deal with literally dozens of bills that improve the law in all sorts of small ways that are done on a very bipartisan, cooperative basis, and it's fun to do that.
Senator Peterson, Senator Padden, thank you both very much. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.